Hi, I am Francesc Campoy, and I'm a developer programs engineer for the Go team here at Google in Mountain View. And today I'm with Kurt.
Hi, I'm Kurt Schwer. I'm on the Google Maps Oceans team, and I work on ocean data with all sorts of different things. But here today, I'd like to talk to you about ships. And we'd like to look at all the ships in the world. There's a lot of them. And what we have is a visualization here that shows you a wide range of what's out there, about all these boats moving around. They're pretty cool, lots of fun stuff going on. But what this is really is a nice visualization of the economic activity of our entire world. So this is really a global scale problem to look at. And what we've got are each individual ship making up just a small fraction of this visualization. The ship starts off with a red at the newest point where it is, and then over time it fades out to a blue color. And it gives you this nice streaky pattern that shows you where the shipping lanes are, where the people run around in circles fishing, where people are doing all that business that they do with on ships. It really is an indicator of what's going on in each particular environment. And what we're getting here is the messages that are actually being broadcast by the ships themselves. And we're picking this up with a satellite going over the top. And a company called SpaceQuest has been kind enough to lend us the data to do this example with. And they're actually collecting these ship positions as they fly over, and then they're reporting them back to us. And what we'd like to do is get millions of points together and look at the overall patterns and trends to see what's happening in our world here. And it's a lot of data, and this, if you just work on a small laptop in your own little environment, it gets very challenging, and your laptop melts under the load of all this, and you don't get very far. So now we're looking at this great visualization here, Francesc, that we've built. How do we get here to the point where we have this amazing ship traffic going on? How do we build something to get from that raw data to this visualization?
Yeah, so that's actually a pretty complex problem to solve. And we ended up creating this diagram here where we can see all the different components that we end up using. So we have the ship sending data through their GPS, the GPS data. And then we get that huge amount of data, lots of points for lots of ships. And we want to extract information out of that. We decided to use BigQuery because you can actually extract information really easily and iterate very fast and just have fun and find cool data about it from a huge amount of data. But we had a little problem, is that we had to upload something which is made of columns. And actually, the data we get from the ships is not at all made of columns, or at least doesn't look like it. It's pretty cryptic. So we had to decode it first. So how did we do that? You actually did it.
Yeah, so it definitely, it's not just encoded, it's armored. So this data comes out in a way that is completely unreadable to a normal human being. But I had a C++ library that I wrote over the last couple years that actually takes that data and converts it into a CSV column format that's pretty manageable. Hmm. And then I wrote a little Python wrapper around that to make it a little bit easier to call. That's great, but you can't run that on App Engine, which is where we're trying to get to. So what we did instead was we brought up a Compute Engine instance with a little Linux virtual machine, and right there we can run the C++ code that I wrote. And it then takes this sort of cron job style, takes data in from cloud storage, turns it into a nice column formatted text format, and then loads it right back into cloud storage and into a different bucket.
It ends up at CSV files pretty much on cloud storage. And then once we have that, loading that data into BigQuery, it's really simple. You just have to do a REST call and just say, okay, there's this new file. I want you to load it onto data set. And now we can actually start having fun and iterating really fast and finding cool data. So we could find faulty GPS signals or ships that were fishing and all of that, really not really simply, because it's actually a pretty complicated problem, but very fast. You can actually just write your query and run it, and in a matter of seconds, you could get that that response. Then to show it on the map, what we had to do is getting that through Penguin app and encode it somehow. So we decided to encode it in binary. But that means that every single time that there was a query coming from the browser, we could go, the App Engine app could query BigQuery, get that information, and encode it and send it to the browser.
So that was pretty fast, right?
Well, that's that's around in the tens of seconds every single time. BigQuery is really fast, actually, when you think about it, considering the huge amount of data that we have. Tens of seconds is actually pretty good. Mm-hmm. But it's definitely not fast enough for a web application, definitely. So that's why we added this intermediary storage, which is data store. So regularly, the App Engine app could go to BigQuery, obtain the latest data, and store it in data store. And now, every time that we get a query, instead of going to BigQuery, we could just get the data from data store. Mm-hmm. So that makes it faster.
But that's not fast enough? I can see.
Yeah, no, really, that's the...
You don't think that's fast enough?
Mm. No, it's fast, but not fast enough. It's going to take less than 1 second, but still around 1 second. And it's taking long because actually, when we get the data from data store, we still have to encode it into binary format. And actually, that's slightly complicated to do. So what we decided to do on top of the data store is to, so we get data from data store, we encode it into binary, and then we store it into Memcache. And now every time that we have a query, what it happens, it's we get it directly, we get just a blob of binary data from Memcache, and we send it back through the HTTP connection.
Now that's fast enough, right?
Now that's fast enough, yes.
Okay. So that's great, but why did you have to go with binary data when most other web applications use just a ASCII JSON?
Yeah, so that's a good question. We started with JSON, actually, and we realized that we had this problem where we're sending a lot of numbers. Latitude, longitude, everything are numbers, pretty much. And we're sending them in JSON, which means that we have the number. We encode it in JSON, therefore text. Mm-hmm. And then it gets to the browser, and the browser has to decode it from text back to a number. And actually, that encoding decoding, it takes time. It takes CPU time. So what we did was just decide to encode everything in binary and use binary arrays in JavaScript, which means that now we can actually get that binary code that we get directly from the HTTP response, put it into memory, and just interpret it as a binary array, an array of floats in our case, and just use that directly as data. So you skip that encoding and decoding part.
And this is why we have millions of points in the browser so quickly.
Yes, that's why you can actually go through the application and just pan around or shift and decide, I want to see the data for this day, and you won't have to wait for 10 seconds. They would just appear automatically, instantly.
Yeah. Great.
What was the part that you learned that was the most interesting for you out of this project?
For me, this was my first time working in the cloud kind of architecture. And I was worried that I would have to wait for my team members to work on different parts of the system. And the neat thing is that I just got to work on my pieces, and all these systems let me decouple and work in my particular favorite language, which is Python. I'm most comfortable there, while you, Frances, were in Go, and I didn't have to, one, worry about the fact that you were working in Go, and I didn't have to wait for you. So for me, that was pretty exciting. How did we pass data back and forth that made that so easy?
Yeah, so since we were we had different independent components, so we had these data loggers and the data transformation and the App Engine app and all that were completely independent and communicating only through data store, just passing the data around and using task queues. And task queues to let the other part of the application know that there's something to do about it. So and that's actually one of the things that I learned and that I discovered that was really powerful, that using task queues, it allows you to have a very robust system pretty much without doing much. Because you know that you're going to try something. And even if your program is faulty and you have some bugs, things that happen sometimes, you won't lose that data. It will actually just fail and send back a message saying, oops, sorry. And it will be automatically retried later on. So you know that data won't ever be lost.
So task queue will pick back up when your code recovers.
Yes, you can of course change the settings to add more backup time or whatever. But the default, actually we're using the default settings and it works perfectly for us. And then the second part for me, well, I'm a Gopher, so of course I use Go for App Engine. And I found out that using Go on the App Engine part was actually a big win, because most of the time on the cloud, what you're doing is waiting for things to happen or doing a lot of things all of a sudden very, very fast. So the fact that you can actually do all of those things very fast at the same time using concurrency, it's something really important. And doing it in Go is actually really easy. You just have to add some Go routines and different channels, and for like 4 or 5 lines of code, you get something that runs concurrently, and you get really big win in efficiency.
Yeah. This is what let us scale when we started loading huge blocks of stuff in multiple.
Yeah, browsers. Especially when you have to load a lot of different things from data store. The fact that you can load all of them at the same time and just wait for the slowest one, that's a big win. Rather than doing sequentially, and if you have 1,000, well, you have to wait for 1,000 times n. So,
yeah. So this is pretty exciting. So now that we have this neat architecture, what do we need to do next to this, or where are we going to be going with it?
Yeah, so I think that the architecture is pretty much ready to be used. And so the cool thing now is that we could consider using this same architecture for very different applications. So the same way you're actually showing here ships on a map, you could also use it to track whales in the ocean, or you could use it to track cars on the highways, or anything that you can think about it, or even not related to maps. You could actually use it, the same architecture, as some way to filter huge amount of data and extract some information that it's
definitely
like something really small, and it's like the very valuable information out of a huge amount of data. So yeah, I think that the next step is just find out what's the new cool application to do with this architecture.
Great.
So also, if you are interested in knowing more about this architecture and how we built it and what we did with it, we gave a talk in the last edition of Google I/O here in San Francisco, and you can find the link here in the description. So look at it, have a look, and enjoy it.
And just so you know, we've released the decoding library libais for the ship messages, if you're interested in playing with that, and we hope to be working through the rest of open sourcing of our little
Yeah, we'll definitely libraries. Open source soon the App Engine app code and probably the data logger and all the rest. So thanks for watching, and keep an eye on Google Developers Live channel for more videos about our projects using different Google products.